Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the planning committee. Can I ask that all mobile phones are turned off or to silent? This meeting will be webcast and a record detained on the council website. The cameras are set to follow microphones. Members, please remember to use your microphone when speaking. If the applicants, petitioners or agents do not wish to be filmed, please let me know before you take your seat to speak. My role is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regards to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people are, to my right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on procedural and legal matters that may arise, and the minute taker and webcasters. To my left are the planning officers, highway engineers and environmental health officer, who will present the applications and provide any technical advice that may be required. Down the sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications and collectively make the decisions. Voting will be by a show of hands. Each application will be introduced by the planning officers. Where there is a qualifying petition of 25 signatures or more, I will invite a representative of the petitioners to address the committee for 5 minutes. I will then invite the applicants or their agent to address the committee for 5 minutes. Statutory and local consultees may also address the committee. The ward councillor can also address the committee. Once representations have been made or following any questions or clarification committee members may have, the speaker must return to the public area and may not participate in any debate that follows within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. When making decisions, members may only have regard to material planning considerations. It is a matter for each member individually to balance these considerations and to decide what weight to give them. Members will also have regard to our local planning policies and to the National Planning Framework and Guidance. The order of tonight's agenda will be varied depending on the number of people in attendance for a specific item. So agenda item number one is to approve the accuracy of the minutes of the meeting held on the 17th of October.
So moved, yeah.
Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Item 2, Members' Code of Conduct and Declarations of Interest. Members of the committee are asked whether they have any personal or prejudicial interests in connection with any application on the agenda, and if so, to declare them and state the nature of the interest.
Thank you, Chair. Declared a personal interest in item 3 through my role as a councillor. I'm in an advised residence of planning procedure while I'm not making a determination on the application.
Chair, can I make a personal declaration, please, on agenda item 4? I have a relative who lives close by the application.
Thanks for that.
Sorry, Chair. And when it's discussed, I'll leave the meeting.
Okay, thank you for that. So, the order of tonight's business there, there's a slight mismatch between the agenda, published agenda, and the online number. There's only 3 items. We will start with the application for the Cheshire Cheese Public House. We'll then move to the application at 33 to 35 Whitehouse Lane, Barnston, and we'll conclude with the application at Wirral Business Park, our book road. Okay, so we will begin with the application of the Cheshire Cheese Public House to Wallasey Village. If the officer could introduce the item, please.
Thank you, Chair. The application site is the Cheshire Cheese Pub and Beer Garden, which exists. Earlier this year, there was consent granted for a couple of structures within the beer garden, and conditions relating to those structures restricted the hours of use, restricted when using ranking by boys to be played in the area. So the application before us tonight is to vary one of those conditions. Condition 3 required that no music, public address system or other amplified sound shall be played in the external area or bar after 7 p.m. in the evening. The current application seeks to play background music until 10 p.m. in the evening. It's proposed that this would be for 4 speakers within the area. To address some concerns about noise issues, part of the proposal includes a noise pollution control system. So what that effectively means is it's a device whereby the music's played through speakers by this, and that's the level of sound is set prior to this being operated in conjunction with local planning authority and barrier protection. So that would set a level of foot noise that's deemed to be acceptable. In addition to this, because obviously we've recently set the hours restriction to 7 p.m, we're looking to only give consent if members are minded to approve for 12 months. So that would enable us to monitor the system, see if it works, see if it's okay, as we believe it is. So on that basis, it is recommended for approval. There is a qualified petition as well, Chair.
Okay, there's a qualified petition. Is there a representative of the petitioner who would like to address us? We'll come forward. Potentially.
Sorry,
just is it, I just. Okay, just begin by giving you the name and address, just for the record.
Only seeking extension of hours for playing background music
and not for entertainment outside. Point 399, they have further proposed the use of a noise pollution control system. We note it has been recommended as a condition and that the device be installed and working and the unit will set the sound level. We further request that you would add to that condition that this system, should it fail for any reason, no other system shall be used. For absolute clarification on planning and licensing precedent, and to avoid any and all confusion for both parties, with regard to daytime activities and noise pollution management, we have some questions to be addressed. Because there does appear to be an anomaly in this public house, in that all regulated activities under current licensing state these must be provided indoors with doors and windows enclosed. However, the outside garden is a licensed premises with no doors or windows. Therefore, we request confirmation. How will amplified sound in the garden be limited before 7 p.m? Will all music and sound outside have to be played through the noise pollution control? We ask this because someone clearly didn't consider the impact of noise to neighbours when granting the initial licence to cover outside garden for entertainment. If the tenant applies for a temporary event licence, for example for a New Year's party, do planning conditions impose a 10:30? Sorry, planning conditions do impose a 10:30 curfew and noise pollution control measures. Are they then disregarded? Finally, permitting an extension of background music despite a proposed 12-month period of probation will impact on one family more than any other. If you do not address the noise nuisance issue and provide clarity as to whether planning conditions supersede licensing conditions, that family will continue to listen to constant noise, loud all day and quieter after 7 p.m. but nevertheless potentially up to 7 days a week, 10 hours a day. They will continue to be forced from their home to seek refuge, peace and quiet. So we ask you please consider most carefully all of your decisions and the conditions that you're able to set and the impact that these conditions will have on the neighbours and community. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Pat. If we can play the video now, then I'll invite members who may have any questions. Did you want to make comments in relation to the video before you finish?
Just to say that the last one with the balustrade was taken from our garden, which is 36 metres away from the pub, across a busy road, and that was at the back of the house. So you could hear clearly the entertainment. The others were taken from the front of our house. That's it, really.
Can I ask if any members have any questions they might wish to put to the chair?
Just one question. Was that live music? No events?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, Steve?
Yeah, just for clarification, the operation of the limiter. If, for instance, the sound level was to go above the actual...
Yeah, I think... I'm case, I'm sure members will have questions on environmental health in due course. It's specifically just on the presentation that we just had before we hear from the applicants. Anything else? Thank you very much for your presentation. Can I ask if there's a representative for the applicant who wishes to speak to us? You come forward.
We've had them inside, we've had problems with internal noise, when it's like a pub in the middle of terrace houses. And we've never had it in the past where we've had anyone tamper with it. You can put a lock on whether that's something to discuss with the HO, I'm not too sure, but we've never had issues in the past with it.
Just a quick one. When we were at the site visits, I am convinced in your mind that when the landlord said there was going to be a canopy over, is that right?
Yes, that's part of the planning.
Is that the acoustic?
Yeah, it's a fabric that's got acoustic. Yeah, it's a retractable canopy.
Thank you.
No worries.
And will
that
canopy be up all the time or just when it rains?
It's a fixed canopy. The actual awning is retractable, so it does come back, but it shouldn't really make it. Obviously, it's an acoustic thing, but at the same time, there shouldn't be any issues because there's a noise restrictor, so that hopefully shall eliminate any noise that is going to travel from the neighbours. Yeah.
So why would you have it if it's the noise restrictor?
Because originally, this wasn't, we were just putting in, we've changed the application for this reason to put the noise limiter in as part of this variation. So originally, obviously we didn't realise it until 7, that was a condition. So we've worked with planning, we've changed the speakers, so we've incorporated actually more speakers, because that was a request from planning to hopefully then reduce the noise, because in the areas where people sat would be able to keep it at a quieter tone. And obviously put the noise restrictor in, obviously at the discussions with the planner, that was kind of a need.
You mentioned earlier about the restriction would be in the beer garden.
Yes.
Will there be any music, live or otherwise, within the pub itself?
There will be live music inside. I would have to obviously consult with him. I don't know how regular that is, but that is part of his licensing, that he does have music inside. And there is a condition on that where he has to have things shut off and closed and everything shut down by a certain time, but that's part of the license. On that.
Is there a noise limiter on the inside?
There isn't at the minute, no.
Okay. And has that been a problem in the past?
I'm sure neighbours will say that has been a problem in the past. I don't know in the last, I know Steve's really tried hard in the last 12 months to reduce all the complaints and work with people and try and work with people at EHO licensing just to make sure that there was a meeting held on site with licensing and EHO, the tenant and the building owner, to arrange set times and set things that they've set out in the licensing agreement.
Just one last question. Yes. Will there be any live music extended outside?
Not outside, no live music outside, no.
So in terms of the clientele, what sort of demographics do we look at? There's nothing with beer festival goes, and we'll talk about.
Yeah, well, the tenant actually got another site now away from this site, he's kind of pushed a lot of the clientele that like the outdoor drinking to that site now. And the pub now is more local, older, it's a much older crowd, there's not as many of the younger people coming because there's this new site, I don't recommend it, but there's another site that's quite a lot further away that Steve is trying to gear that crowd to kind of alleviate the issues as much as he can.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're in the space of the planning committee has been in the past, where it's considered planning application, with conditions. And residents have put to us, and applicants indeed have put to us, conditions that are already set by licensing and who takes priority, etc. Our understanding in the past has always been that the more onerous condition, whether it comes from licensing or from planning, is the one that must be followed by the applicant. Licensing obligations or planning obligations are set under a different legislative framework. But don't take my word for this, I shall bring in the planning officer just to say a few words on licensing conditions, planning conditions, and how they all fit together.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, they're basically they're two different regimes of regulation, and they don't always meet. So you can have a situation where someone can be licensed for things that can't happen through the planning consent. So in this instance, if they, even if they're licensing allowing them to play music at later hours than their planning consent does, we could enforce the planning consent. They would be in breach of the planning consent and we could take enforcement action on that basis. So there are they're just two separate regimes that the council can exactly do.
Okay,
members.
Thank you.
Thanks for the clarification from the planning officer. I'd like to hear from the environmental health officer if I may, because when we're on site visit, there was some discussion about the noise, the limitations that can be put on the noise, and what the council as a whole can do to mitigate some of the effects that the residents have outlined to us in the presentation. Could I ask through you, sir, that the environmental health officer talks us through that?
Okay, thank you. Through you, Chair. We originally started getting complaints in 2017 when I believe the new licensee took over. And through monitoring, we did establish that there was a problem there. And with working with the landlord, there was a management plan put in place through licensing, which then reduced and brought the levels down to acceptable. Since then, there have been sporadic complaints. But these have been related to live music events. And further monitoring last year throughout hot summer and everything, there was no evidence of a statutory nuisance from these live events. The proposal that's here, put forward here, is that the music outside, the more speakers you've got, will give a coverage and will require a lower level and go through the noise limiter device as well. Someone mentioned before that is set and it's on a key system. So once all the music going outside will go through this limiter device. If anyone tries to up the source volume, once it goes through this limiting device, it will just cut it off totally, and then it will not come back on again until they've lowered it back down to the level. And that is set by a key, so you can't override it at all. Therefore, because of the proposal of background music only, noise limiting device and more speakers being handled, and the lack of live music, we've considered that we can't object at this stage. What we do have is powers, should the committee be minded to pass this, approve this, complaints coming through. We would monitor, we have powers under the Environmental Protection Act for statutory noise nuisance, irrespective of what time of day. So this could be before 7 o'clock, it could be, it doesn't matter about the time. So we could take action under the Environmental Protection Act, and the other power we have is that we can, as one of the statutory consultees for licensing, it's called the licensing to review as well.
But again, I stress the point, I'm unfamiliar with the equipment, so what is to stop the power supply to the noise limiting equipment being turned off? What happens then? If somebody flicked the switch by mistake and the power was turned off to the noise limiting equipment, what happens then?
Literally, all the music goes through this noise limiting device and then out to the speakers. So if the power's gone, there will be nothing going through to the outside.
Thanks, Kev. Just two further points if I may. In terms of the management plan that you said had been agreed with the tenant, you've made reference in your remarks that the noise management plan had been agreed with the tenant following complaints from neighbours since 2017, I think.
Yes, that's through licensing the management plan.
Right. And that management plan is public information, is it?
I believe so, from the licensing point of view. Yes.
Okay, the last question, can you tell me what the difference is between background music and any other music?
The suggestion of background music is that it is what it says. If it's on a low level, it's not above, so you're not obscuring normal conversation levels or anything like that. So by its very nature, if you were setting up with these noise limiting devices, you can set them on whatever level is appropriate for the premises you're talking about. So with this one, because the application is for background level, the level can be set down there, so it's not above.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Looking at the video that we were shown before, I must admit, I think if I lived in the area and I was listening to that all day, I think it probably would drive me mad. But from what I understand, I would like an assurance that the type of level that we're talking about now, low-level amplified music, will be nothing like the volume that we heard on the video before. Is that correct?
Thank you, through you, Chair. I'm not privy to the dates of the videos. Some early videos were from the sort of 2017, 2018 era. I'm not sure if those are as well. When we acknowledged that there was an issue in 2017. However, as I say, that was from live music events. Yeah. But going forward, if there is a problem, then yes, we will monitor and look at it from the same point of view.
Thank you, Chair.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I think I'm probably correct in saying that when you sort of do this monitoring, that you're measuring the decibel level of some sort and seeing that level's breach, would that be correct?
Yes and no. The main method we rely on is particularly for a public house situation is an officer actually goes and monitors personally. So it's subjective. Can I clearly hear it? Is it causing an interference to the enjoyment of their property? And so a number of officers have been out on various weekends and Friday evenings between the hours of 8 and 10 when these events have been coming up to monitor to see if it was a nuisance, but our recent monitoring hasn't suggested that. So it's not so difficult to say above one level is a nuisance and below one isn't, because you have to take time of day, duration, background noise into account as well. So it would be an officer actually going out and monitoring from the various points around the public house.
Okay, let me just follow up on that then. Let's say hypothetically did go out and the inside of the venue is playing some very, very loud music, and you were sort of hearing it outside, it's very, very loud, but might not necessarily be from the back of the music in the back. What's the position then?
From our point of view, it doesn't matter whether it's a licensing condition, a planning condition, or what time of day it is. If it's a statutory noise nuisance, it's what it says. So we would take action irrespective of the other departments.
Just make the point that presumably looking at the hours, it's past, to be frank, the town hall's closing time. So if the neighbours have a problem with music, say at 9:30 or 10 o'clock, and it's too loud, practically how are they going to notify the departments that there's a problem, and how are you going to get somebody out there? And I'm not clear on that.
Thank you, through you, Chair. What we've had in the past is that the issue was live music events. So, for instance, we have been notified in advance by local residents of a live music event coming up. So what we have done is we've arranged for an officer to go out between those times to monitor firsthand. The public house don't know that we're coming, so we've turned up when the event's on to monitor from there. If we're aware that, for instance, the background music is regularly at a level that residents deem unacceptable, then again we would call out. We call out at all sorts of hours. We're walking around Middle Birkenhead at 2 o'clock in the morning monitoring those, so that's not an issue for us.
Thank you, Chair. Question for the environmental officer again. You said about the noise restriction, the noise limiter. Who actually sets that? Is that set by an environmental officer? Or is it set by somebody within the pub itself?
Okay, thank you, through you, Chair. The condition, I believe, that's been put in the planning application is that it will be set in conjunction with the local council.
So by an environmental officer?
Yes, yeah.
Some clarity with regards to this noise limiter device. Is this a case of just sort of cables plugging into a device and sort of going to and from, or are these cables hardwired in so there is no way of unplugging and then bypassing the device?
Okay, thank you for you, Chair. No, it's a fixed device that's hardwired in. and so literally there isn't any way to bypass it unless it's it is one of our key switch operation. So to my mind, you know, about experience, not recent experience of noise limiters, and the back rooms for the industrial power of military equipment, the noise levels reach a certain level. So that satisfies me that the noise nuisance will be dealt with by technological means. Think of the general philosophical point. Is it ever so difficult these days to sustain a business? Given the technology that we use to the noise, I don't think we should place any more values to this business be sustainable. I don't have any problems as to where the previous application.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I wasn't in any need to rush other members making the points, but reading the report itself and listening to the response from the Environmental Health Officer, especially in 3911, 3912 in the report, and 3914, is that they're asking for recommendation that we allow this, and it's monitored for 12 months. I'm quite happy to support the application.
Okay, Chair, I can just ask a final question then. In terms of the noise monitoring equipment and the recommendation in the report that says you're going to monitor it for 12 months, does the noise monitoring equipment compile any sort of log of any breaches of the noise? Do we know, for example, how many times it may have shut down because it's been exceeded the fixed level? Would we know that unless we were there?
Thank you, through you, Chair. There's no actual noise monitoring equipment being installed. There's a noise limiter device.
Sorry, my wrong choice of words. The noise limiting device.
Yes.
Is there any way for you to know if it's been shut down because of the noise that exceeded the limit that you've set?
Well, again, if we were out monitoring and we could clearly hear it, you would know that there was some issue with the noise monitoring device, and at that point we could go in and check what was going on as to whether there was an issue or not.
So in terms of monitoring for 12 months, then that is reactive, isn't it? Because what are you basically saying, for 12 months we're going to monitor it based on resident complaints?
Thank you, through you, Chair. From our point of view, it doesn't even have to be 12 months. We will monitor at any time. Condition is, I think, that these hours are being put forward for 12 months with a review afterwards. So from our point of view, if we get a complaint next week, we will go out and monitor.
In that case, sorry, if you've monitored this over the next 12 months, say, during the period of this permission, and there's been a number of breaches or complaints from residents, do we as a planning committee then, in 12 months' time, have the power to say, well, no further?
Through you, Chair, this consent only lasts for 12 months. The variation is only for 12 months. That would have to be, the condition requires it to be resubmitted and reassessed after that period.
Thank you, Chair. Sorry, I thought I was clear on the technology and after Lewis's question. I'm slightly less. You referred to it being breached, but as far as I understand it, just passing the application, it's not whether it's the limit has been breached, it's whether the limit has been attempted to be breached. Is that correct? Because it can't go louder, it's just someone could attempt to put it louder, is that right?
If it's operated correctly, then someone trying to turn it louder will automatically cut out.
So it wouldn't ever go louder, it would just cut out?
It would cut out, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Just missed out a small piece when I was talking before. I did ask the resident the question. With the videos that we saw playing music, the residents replied yes, and from the report itself, it's 12 months since any live music has been played outside, according to applicant's agent. I think, given the recommendations that are in the report itself, it's well worth supporting.
I think we need to sort of have a sense of sort of balance about the debate, really. I mean, the Cheshire Cheese pub has been there since I can ever remember, and probably everyone in this room. It is a well-established public house, and depending on your
your view, a public house in your area is either a blessing or sometimes could be considered a curse. And there are issues around public houses where whenever you position them. It sounds to me as though people are trying to be as reasonable as possible whilst trying to maintain what is now a modern, traditional, modern type sort of public house. So you can expect there to be events or occasional music in a pub. People do enjoy the idea of drinking outside or sitting outside, particularly during summer months and so on and so forth. And it is reasonable to expect them to have, perhaps have some level of background music. I mean, for example, you're sitting in your own back garden, next door decides to come out and put their radio on in the back garden. It depends on your level of tolerance of what you deem acceptable. And I don't think the planning committee can actually be the judge of who's tolerant and who isn't tolerant of levels of noise. The environment officers have the tools and weapons to do that. It sounds to me as though the applicant has certainly considered their position within the local community and has done everything reasonably required to mitigate the circumstances while still trying to sustain and manage a business. And, for every time a pub gets a complaint about it, every time a pub seems to shut down, we get masses of complaints saying we've lost a part of our community. So it's no doubt about in my mind that the Cheshire Cheese is lock, stock and barrel part of that local community. And I hope the two can coexist together with local residents. And I think this is a valid attempt to meet problems of the past, but we're not judging here problems of the past. We're attempting to allow a planning application specifically about the noise and emanating from the garden. We're not the licensing committee, and I think we officers, applicants, and indeed the contributions of the residents have certainly been listened to, that there's a valid attempt here to make this thing work for everyone. And we have the backstop, of we can review in 12 months if that hasn't been applied for. So my view would be to actually try and promote and keep this community up on its feet and going whilst trying to mitigate any circumstances, residents. I think it's a reasonable attempt to marry the two together. And I certainly haven't heard all of their technology behind it would probably be in favour of support in this segment.
Okay, thanks for that, members. That was a balanced discussion, and hopefully we learned something about the monitoring of noise. It is very clearly a residential area just outside the more retail area of Wallasey Village. So, to that extent, it is an activity taking place predominantly in a residential area. My understanding is the original application was for an extension of entertainment rather than background. Residents would quite rightly have been concerned at an extension from 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock on the basis of entertainment. I think officers, planning officers have worked on that description and have done some work so that we're not looking at entertainment any longer as a description. I think we're looking at background music and I think we've tried to tease out a definition of that in terms of where it sits, in terms of conversations, etc. It's no surprise to me that residents were concerned initially in the official application, given the video, which, as has been mentioned, wasn't date stamped, but was potentially a flavour of what has happened in the past that has caused concern